Hey, everybody. I'm Natasha Kirchuk, and thanks for joining us for ILTV's weekly program, One-on-One with Alan Dershowitz. We want to give you, our viewers, a chance to have your questions answered by Professor Dershowitz, one of America's greatest legal minds. He's a leading expert on criminal and constitutional law, civil liberties, and the Arab-Israeli conflict. Today, we have a special edition of the show where we recapture the finest moments and commentary, bringing you the best of One-on-One with Alan Dershowitz. I hope you're ready because we have a very special guest today. Joining us now is a former Minister of Defense, Moshe Bogi Yaalon. General Yaalon has also served as the Minister of Strategic Affairs and Intelligence following a lengthy career in the Israeli military, which culminated in him serving as the commander of the IDF. So let's get started. General Yaalon, it's pretty fair to say that today's most pressing issue is, of course, Iran and the Iran nuclear deal. We're waiting to see how the Trump administration and the entire world will choose to handle the future of the deal, especially in light of Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu's recent primetime special revealing what he claims are thousands of documents taken from Iran's nuclear facilities in Tehran. Netanyahu claims these files are proof enough that the current deal with Iran is a no-go. Now, General Yaalon, what is your take on the deal? Does it work? And if not, what is the alternative? Is there an alternative?
First of all, thank you for having me in your program. And I would like to start by basics. Israel didn't consider Iran as an enemy. We had very good relations with Iran in the past, but since the revolution of 1979, the current regime declared that Israel should be wiped off the map of the earth. So they declared us as an entity we should disappear because of certain ideology. Nowadays, they deploy proxies against us, and they still keep the vision to acquire military nuclear capability, to use it against us, to use it against other adversaries in the region regarding the Shia-Sunni conflict, even without any connection to the state of Israel. So from the very beginning, we said, by one way or another, the military nuclear project in Iran should be stopped. And there was an opportunity in which this regime decided to be engaged politically to try to reach a kind of agreement. At the end, the outcome was the JCPOA, the nuclear deal, which we consider a tremendous historic mistake. Actually, this deal allows Iran to keep their indigenous capabilities to produce a bomb. Just a delay for a decade or so, that's it. And ignoring the other activities of the regime, like proliferation of arms and terror, a violation of UN Security Council resolution, the missile project, part of the nuclear idea, ignored in this deal. So what we claim that this deal should be at least fixed, but nevertheless, without dealing with the deal, this regime should be sanctioned immediately because of the violations that I just mentioned and were ignored on the deal. This is my view about it.
Well, I have several questions, obviously, but Professor Dershowitz, do you want to give your take?
Sure. First of all, General Yaalon has contributed so much to Israel safety, security, and in his new roles as a civilian, he has contributed enormously to the dialogue. He's a wonderful, wonderful man. Every Israeli should be so proud of having somebody as brilliant as General Yaalon at the head of its military for so long a period of time, and whenever he speaks, I listen very, very carefully. I agree with virtually everything he said. I do think that the deal cannot be allowed to go forward if it has sunset provisions. At the very least, sunset provisions have to be eliminated, and Iran has to be kept to its word, which it said in the beginning of the deal, that Iran reaffirms that it will never, under any circumstances, seek to acquire or develop nuclear weapons. That's number one. Number two, there must be a much more vigorous inspection methodology. They can't exempt certain places from inspection because they're military facilities. Those are precisely the facilities that have to be looked at. You know, when you do a search and a seizure in somebody's home and the person says, you can search every room but the foyer, obviously that's the room you want to search. And so I think the deal has to be fixed. And if it can't be fixed, it has to be eliminated. I'd rather see it fixed. But people say that the sanctions can't be restored. Let's remember that American sanctions alone are very powerful, particularly banking sanctions. Even if no one else in the world follows them, everybody wants to do business with America and wants to do business with American banks. So we still have leverage, and we should use that leverage to make sure that sunset provisions and the inspection provisions are changed dramatically.
Well, I'd like to move on to yet another security issue. Unfortunately, we're just running out of time here, so I want to make sure that we get into this. This issue comes from the South. A series of Palestinian protests have been launched by Hamas in the Gaza Strip, demanding that Palestinian refugees and their descendants be allowed to return to what is now current-day Israel. Hamas claims these protests are supposed to be a peaceful sit-in, but there have been waves of Palestinians attempting to breach the border with Israel and many violent clashes along the way. Israeli forces have killed dozens of Palestinian protesters, many of whom are Hamas militants that have been intent on launching terror attacks. And also many weapons and improvised explosive devices have been found near the border. But the international community is accusing Israel of using excessive lethal force in response to these threats. Danny, what is really happening on the ground here?
Well, what's happening on the ground is a very cynical, ruthless ploy by Hamas to discomfort Israel, to render it a pariah state, to make Israel look bad. As they always try to do. And for that, they're willing to sacrifice their own children, their own women, by putting them as a human shield. Now, it's not just women and children, because amongst these women and children, they do have some snipers and some terrorists in order to get into the fence, to harm Israel, to harm Israeli military and soldiers. Of course, Israel is trying to do its best to keep its sovereignty like any other normal country would do. And this is what we're doing. And, you know, the Hamas, they thought a million people will march. Then they thought maybe 100,000. Only 30,000 came. Last week, only 20,000 came. That shows how reluctant the Palestinians in Gaza are to do that. They also understand the Hamas ploy. What is the double standard here that the international community is blaming Israel and not the Hamas? The Hamas leaders should be the ones tried in the Hague Tribunal.
Well, that's obviously what I would like to get to. And obviously, you know, Professor Dershowitz, you're in the United States right now, so you're kind of experiencing this on the ground. How is this impacting Israel's public image? You know, many are claiming that these protests are really a public relations battleground more than anything, and are essentially opening a front in what is known as lawfare, or a sort of potential legal attack on Israel.
Well, this is, happens every few years. It's like a recurring holiday, except it's not a holiday. Hamas has developed what I call its dead baby strategy. Ambassador Alon referred to it in more benign terms, but it uses babies and it hopes that the babies will be killed so that they can appear on television. It actually offers a bounty to families. If you allow one of your babies to be killed, we will pay you money for that. It's absolute blood money. I think Americans and the international community are getting a little bit used to and a little bit tired of this ploy. This is not a demonstration a la Martin Luther King. It is a violent demonstration. There ought to be demonstrations, nonviolent demonstrations in Gaza against Hamas, because Hamas is destroying the lives of the residents of Gaza. They ought to be rising up in wrath. Gaza could have been Singapore in the Mediterranean when Israel ended its occupation 10 years ago, more than 10 years ago, 13 years ago. Instead, they use the money coming from countries around the world that's supposed to be for humanitarian purposes to launch rockets and build tunnels. And the victims have been the people of Gaza. The people of Gaza claim they have a right of return. It's never been part of international law that 50 years later, your great-grandchildren, second cousins, great-nephews, and nieces have a right to return to a place that most of them left voluntarily at the urging of leaders of the anti-Israel group, So this is a fake demonstration designed only to hurt Israel in the court of public opinion, and I think Americans are getting used to it, and I think it's working less and less, and I think the time has come for the people of Gaza to rise up against the Hamas leaders, to elect, if they can do it, members of the Palestinian Authority to create a unified Palestinian Authority that seeks peace and rejects the right of return and rejects violence, and maybe then the basis for a two-state solution, a peaceful resolution, will appear. But right now, Gaza and Hamas are a barrier to peace and a barrier to resolving the Palestinians' claim.
You recently had a very special meeting in the White House, and Robert Katz is joining us. He's an American scientist and engineer known for his groundbreaking work in developing the GPS, the Iron Dome, and the email, and he wants to ask you all about your dinner.
Hi, Alan. This is Robert Katz. I'm happy to be here in Tel Aviv. We're about to launch, as you know, the World Innovation Network, connecting the innovation capital of the world with the commerce capital of the world in New York. I understand that you had dinner with another one of my friends from Washington, President Trump. Maybe you could share with us your thoughts, what you talked about. We'd love to know. And most importantly, thank you for your service to Israel and to the United States. We appreciate it so much.
First of all, thank you. It's a great, great honor to have you on our show. You have done so much, not only for innovation, technology, to make the life of everybody better, but you've done so much for Israel and for the Israeli-American relationship. I think of you when I think of what the peace dividend would be if Israel and the Palestinians could make peace and Israel could turn its swords into plowshares and its nuclear weapons into nuclear medicine. You would be at the head of that campaign to benefit not only the Israelis and the Palestinians, but everybody in the world with Israeli innovation and technology. I just want to correct one minor point you mentioned. Donald Trump is your friend. Donald Trump is not my friend. I did not vote for him. I voted against him. I do not support his policies on immigration. I do not support his approach to what happened in Charlottesville. I wrote an op-ed critical of that in the Wall Street Journal. I support only his due process and civil liberties rights. I'd be doing exactly the same thing if Hillary Clinton had been elected president and they were yelling, lock her up, and pointing a special counsel to investigate her emails and raiding the offices of her lawyer. The only difference is if it were Hillary Clinton, the American Civil Liberties Union would be on my side. Most of my family members and friends would be on my side, and many of the people who are now on my side would be on the other side. So I try very hard to stick only to principle and civil liberties and not to be a partisan. I have some of the same concerns about what's going on in Israel with Benjamin Netanyahu. Of course, there's a difference. Benjamin Netanyahu is my friend. He has been my friend for many, many years. I don't support all of his policies. I've been extremely critical of his change of mind when it came to the African asylum seekers and refugees. I had applauded his initial decision, and now I'm very critical of his second decision to rescind his initial decision. But I'm going to support his due process rights and his civil liberties as well. Now to my dinner with President Trump. So I was invited about a week ago to come to the White House and spend hours talking to White House staffers about the Israel-Palestinian issue and about the Middle East in general. I've advised and spoken to every president, Jimmy Carter, George W. Bush, President Clinton, President Obama, all candidates, anybody who wants to hear my views on Israel and the Middle East, I'm there for them. And so I came to the White House to share my views with White House staffers. And then the president invited me to have a dinner with him. I am not his lawyer. I do not give him legal advice. I only give legal advice to people with whom I'm in a legal relationship. But at dinner, we discussed a wide range of subjects. I don't feel comfortable specifically talking about what I talked about with the president or White House staffers. That deserves a degree of confidentiality. I can tell you, though, that we discussed a range of issues from the Middle East to what's going on in the world today and what's going on in the United States in terms of legal issues. He was very upbeat. He was very optimistic about the potential for doing something regarding foreign policy in North Korea, in Syria, Israel, Palestine, the Gulf states. He seemed knowledgeable and involved in these issues, as well as obviously in the issues that everybody's talking about concerning him being a subject of an ongoing investigation. He knows my views on special counsel, which are very negative. I much prefer the Israeli system, where you have an independent attorney general. You don't need special counsel. The same is true in England and other Western democracies. So right now, he is supportive of my efforts to try to create a fair environment, but he would not be supportive if we got into discussions about immigration, the wall, the travel ban, a woman's right to choose abortion, gay marriage, gun control, separation of church and state. So it's important to understand where I stand on these issues. I'm doing this purely on the basis of principle, even though I've been accused of doing it for money, for power. I want to be the attorney general. I want to be his lawyer. All these accusations, some of which border on anti-Semitic tropes. Jews do it for the money, Jews do it for the power, and never do anything for principle. It reminds me of pinkwashing. Israel does such a good job on gay rights, and yet its opponents say, well, it's doing it only for tactical reasons to pinkwash, to cover up how bad it treats the Palestinians. That's what people are saying about me today, too. But I'm going to continue to fight for principle, whether it involves attacks on President Trump, on Senator Bob Menendez, on other congressmen or senators, or on Benjamin Netanyahu. I do not believe in the criminalization of political differences. That's why I wrote a book called Trumped Up, How the Criminalization of Political Differences Endangers Democracy. And that's why I want to continue to make this argument for principle. And, Mr. Katz, I want to continue to encourage you and others to help cement the relationship between Israel and the United States and continue to do great things for technology, for health, for innovation, and for Israel. So thank you so much, Mr. Katz, for doing everything you do. And I'd love to spend more time with you either in New York or when we get to Israel. I remember our meetings previously, and I'd love to renew that.
Prime Minister Ehud Olmert is here with us. He served as the leader of Israel from 2006 to 2009 after also serving as the mayor of Jerusalem for nearly a decade. Many claim that his landmark offer of peace to the Palestinians in 2008 was perhaps the most generous ever. But the other side never accepted the deal, and we'll get more into that later during our discussion. Now, it seems, however, that another landmark decision that Prime Minister Olmert made while in power also affected the future of the state of Israel. Under his leadership, Israel attacked and destroyed a secret nuclear reactor that was being built in Syria with the help of North Korea. And that is where we're going to begin this dialogue. Thanks for joining us. And I believe this is your first English language interview.
In quite some time. Life.
No, not in your life. Not in your life, but in quite some time.
This is, as of late.
Which is very big deal for us, obviously. Yeah. But let's start.
I refused all the requests for interviews. But when I was asked whether I will agree to take part in a program with Alan Dershowitz, how could I say no?
Of course, how could you say no? All right, well, what we would like to do is begin with talking about the nuclear threat from Syria. Can you take us back to what went on in your head the first day you heard about the nuclear threat from Syria, and take us inside those talks with America, with President Bush and Condoleezza Rice at the time?
Naturally, when I first heard about the atomic reactor, I know it will change the priorities of my position as Prime Minister of Israel for a period of time until everything will be resolved. This was a major threat. Perhaps the real greatest threat that Israel faced, maybe since its creation. It's true that the Iranian threat of nuclear weapons is something that we should take very seriously. We take it very seriously, but Iran is way behind a possession of a real capacity. While here, there was a nuclear plutonic reactor that was almost at the last phase of its building. And once it would have warmed up, it was unlikely that we could destroy it because the terrible pollution, particularly near the river Euphrates, could have created a terrible, terrible outcome to the lives of millions of people. And this is something that we may have not been able to do. So once we realize that there is an atomic reactor and that this reactor is
quite close to completion. We shared information with the President of America, at that time George W. Bush. I made a special trip to America. Of course, we didn't conceal any of the facts, and no one knew about it except for the heads of the CIA and the National Security Advisor and the President himself and the Vice President. We discussed the possible option of America destroying the atomic reactor. The reason I talked to the President about this was not because I thought that Israel couldn't do it. There was no question in my mind that if Israel will have to, of course, we will destroy the atomic reactor. But I thought that since Israel said that the ultimate responsibility for the prevention of any atomic capabilities by Iran is the primary responsibility of America and the big powers,
right.
I thought that it could be a very important signal to Iran had America destroyed the atomic reactor in Syria on the same basis that America says we will not allow any irresponsible leadership any place in the world to possess weapons that could create mass destruction.
Well, the United States opted for a diplomatic route, which is not what Israel ultimately did.
The president actually, after a while, you know, of discussions and inquiries and analysis and whatnot, finally, on the 13th of July, 2008, he called me. This was Friday afternoon. I was earlier at the birth of the son of my secretary, and we came back to the office and we had this call with the president. The president said, my buddy, I'm sorry, but America will not support a military action, neither by America nor by Israel, and so I offer you a diplomatic effort, and I'm prepared to send the Secretary of State. Within 2 days, she will come to Israel and you'll hold a press conference and you'll wage an international campaign against Syria with the assistance of America. This will be a very effective campaign, and at the end of it, Syria will not have a nuclear nuclear reactor. And I said to the president, President, I understand that you can't do it for whatever reasons that you have. I understand you will not do it. I will do it.
That wraps up this edition of One-on-One with Alan Dershowitz. If you'd like Professor Dershowitz to answer your questions, go to ILTV.tv or our Facebook page and submit them. We'll see you again next week.